Revelation chapter 12 and verse 11, the Bible says, "And they overcame him, the devil, because of the blood of the Lamb and because of the word of their testimony, and they did not love their life even when faced with death." Let me read it for you again. "And they overcame him because of the blood of the Lamb and because of the word of their testimony, and they did not love their life even when faced with death." This is a very wonderful passage of scripture where it talks about how the saints have overcome the enemy. The saints have overcome their problems, or the saints have overcome whatever adversaries they might have faced in life. And the Bible says they overcame. Say those words together with me. They. Who are they? You know, that's a good question. Are you part of that they that the Bible is talking about? If you are part about the overcomers, would you lift your hand and shout a big hallelujah? Because this particular month you are going to overcome. And how are we going to overcome? You know, many people use this word, "I am undergoing a problem." But God is talking about overcoming the problem. And we need to understand how that works in our life. Because as a Christian, we are not prone to having problems in life. Or we are not kind of, you know, we are prone to face challenges and every kind of situation that may come against us. But in the midst of all that, the Bible says they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. The Bible says, "Know the truth and the truth shall set you free." So two important things, very important things that we need to understand. One, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Would you say it together with me? How did they overcome? By the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. These are all filled with truth, filled with doctrine that will set you free in your life. So how did these people overcome in their life? The Bible says by the blood of the Lamb. Again, the question needs to be asked, what did the blood of Christ do for you and for me? When we partake of the communion, you know, we say this is the blood that has been shed for us. Why blood is very, very important? The Bible declares without the shedding of the blood, there is no remission of sin. So if sin has to be dealt with, then blood has to be shed. And this particular concept you can find in many of the religions which talk about, you know, shedding of the blood of goats or animals or even human blood in order to get rid of the problem that they find themselves in. But the Bible says, you know, just the blood of anything will not do the job for us. That is why the Bible declares in Hebrews chapter 9, we are going to look at what Christ has accomplished and how we can appropriate the accomplishment in our life. That is why by the word, by the blood, and by the word of our testimony. Come with me to Hebrews chapter 9. Let's look at what the blood of Christ has accomplished for us. When we partake of the communion, this is not some kind of a Christian ritual, but rather it is an expression of our relationship with God. Hebrews chapter 9 and verse 12. The Bible says, "And not through the blood of goats and calves, but through his own blood, he entered the holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption." The Bible says, having obtained eternal redemption, he entered the most holy place once for all. By one sacrifice, the Bible says, he has accomplished eternal redemption for you and for me. So the first thing that the blood of Christ has accomplished for you and for me is that we are eternally redeemed. Say those words together with me. We are eternally redeemed. That is why we sang this song, "Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it." But if you don't know what redemption is all about, singing about it will not be as enthusiastic as it should be. So what is redemption? You know, take the word redeem, for example. You know, that word is commonly used in a particular context when some of you, or not any of you for that matter, if a person goes and, you know, mortgages his jewels or whatever, you know, to the bank and gets a loan out of it, and they use these words, you know, "I have to redeem my jewels." Have you come across that particular word? you know, just come across the word, but don't get into the situation. Are you with me? So I have to redeem, you know, Tamil again, nagayai meetka vendum. I have to redeem, you know, because I have lost it. How did you lose it? Because you do not know how to govern yourself. As a result of that, you know, lack of governance, lack of wisdom, lack of understanding, you got into a problem and you have to get out of the problem. You know, if you know how to get out of the problem, then why is mankind still in a problem? The problem is, he does not know how to get out of the problem. And that is why the Bible says, for God so loved the world that he sent his only begotten son, that none should perish but all should have eternal life. So, you know, when Adam committed the sin, the whole of, he was a representative man. When he lost, all of us lost. As a result of that, a child, when it is born, it's called an inbuilt system in itself. As it grows, something grows with it. And one final day, you are surprised that you can your child can talk like that. Even our parents were surprised when we started talking like that. Are you with me? So we come fully built, you know, fully loaded, to use another expression. So we have a problem that we got ourselves into, maybe not because you personally got into it, but since you have the propensity to do that, one way or the other you will get into that particular problem. And the Bible says Christ redeemed us from the problem. Say those words together with me. Christ has redeemed us from the problem. And redemption includes, you know, this particular word is very, very important. Why did God redeem you? And how did he redeem you? And what is the extent of redemption? The Bible says we have eternal redemption. Say it together with me, we have eternal. Why is that very, very important? You know, every word in the Bible is important. The Bible says man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word. So eternal, what is eternal? Everlasting redemption. In other words, when God gets you out of the problem, you don't have to get into it any longer. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. That is eternal redemption. What's the point of rescuing somebody and you rescue him today and tomorrow he gets into the same problem? And whenever a problem gets reverted, the intensity of the problem increases. You know, so that is why the Bible again says, you know, those who have been delivered from sin willingly, willfully, you know, if they go back and get caught into it, their later days will be much more worse than their former days. You know, if that is the problem, the Bible here says we have been redeemed by an eternal redemption. That simply means when God rescues you from a problem, you don't have to get back into it again. For that, you need to know the truth and the truth shall set you free. So the Bible says what is redemption? It is immediate and it is eternal. Two important words. Redemption is immediate. Remember the thief on the cross. He says, Lord, do remember me when you come in your kingdom. And what did Jesus say? Today you shall be with me in paradise. What is the point of saying today? It simply means God's redemption is immediate and it is eternal. And let me tell you this morning, you can receive the touch of God not in the days that are going to come. It can be had immediately and it can last for eternity. Lift your hand and say big amen to that. That is what we are partaking of the communion. When you partake of the communion, you are saying, I am eternally redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. What is eternal redemption means? Again, come with me to Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 7. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 7. What does the Bible say? In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespass according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished on us in all wisdom and insight. Let me read it again for you, verse 7. In him we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, or the forgiveness of our sins. Let me take you back to the same logic again. Rescue a person, and if you don't give him the empowerment of not getting into the problem again, what will happen? He will get into the problem again. And the Bible says, you know, sin is the basic problem that we all have. What is sin again? You know, to do that which you shouldn't be doing, and the vice versa of it kind of summarizes sin. To put it in another context, sin is missing the mark. To put it in another context still, sin is enthroning yourself and dethroning God. Whenever God is not in the place in which He needs to be in a person's life, the Bible says there is some way that seems right to man, but it will end in death, meaning separated from God. And the Bible says redemption includes forgiveness of our sins. What is the point of forgiving when I keep on sinning? You understand what I'm trying to say? Somebody said it, I said it many times, I'll say it again. I like sinning and God likes forgiving. You know, so I keep on sinning, I keep on confessing, and God keeps on forgiving me. What is the whole point of it? Forgiveness, not only God forgives you of your sin, the Bible says grace, proper understanding of grace is this: grace forgives you, but it also empowers you not to do it again. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. Now say these words together with me. I am eternally redeemed. But you might be saying, I still have a problem. That is why the Bible says, know the truth and the truth shall set you free. So the Bible says that our sins are forgiven, and redemption includes the forgiveness of our sin. To put it in another context, redemption is deliverance. Say this word together with me. Redemption is what? It's deliverance. It's God setting us free. Remember Galatians chapter 5 and verse 1. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free. You know, many people will say, you know, even before I came to know Christ, I was a free man. You know, I had a free will and did whatever I wanted to do. Yes, that is true, but you need to understand the context of it. You were free to sin, but not free to do God's will. That was the problem. But when Christ sets you free, you are free to do God's will, and you are free not to commit a sin. If you understand, you can overcome your problem. Many people say, you know, I cannot do it. I'm not in control. I cannot do anything. I just accept the status quo and I just keep on going. No, the Bible says that is not your life. That is not how it should be. God has given you the empowerment to change the direction of your life, and it can be changed once you know that He has brought you out of the problem, not for you to get back into it again. Pastor, but I've already got back into it. No problem. He can still bring you out and teach you this morning not to get back in again. Parents, we use this expression. How many times should I tell you? God, if God asked us, how many times should I tell you? Well, keep on telling. You know, faith comes by hearing, and hearing and understanding and conviction and confession and contact, it all works together. And one fine day you will realize, God has brought me out of that problem. I don't have to go back into it. Greater is He that is in me than he that is in the world. Till that place comes in your spiritual life, you need to keep on listening to the word of God. Bible says that He has delivered us. Salvation includes deliverance. In other words, it's not just bringing you out of a problem, but preserving you or keeping you free in the freedom that God has already given us. Come with me to Colossians chapter 1. You will find out how Paul puts it across when he talks about deliverance that comes in our life. Colossians chapter 1 and verse 13 onwards. For He rescued us from the domain of darkness. Domain meaning control or domination of darkness, and has transferred us to the kingdom of His beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of our sin. Can you see the connection? Forgiveness includes the redemption includes the forgiveness of sins. Your redemption also includes deliverance from the power of domain or the control of darkness. God rescues us from that control, and He has transferred us into the kingdom of His Son. To put it in another way, to make it very simple, the devil does not have any authority over you. I'm going to say it again. The devil does not have any authority over you. How are you going to say it together with me? The devil does not have any authority. என்ன கேட்டுட்டு பிரச்சனை பண்ணிட்டான்னா You understand what I'm trying? Oh, come on, out loud, together with me. The devil does not have any authority over me. Tell your neighbor, the devil does not have any authority over you. What happens if I say it and he gives me problems? That is why you have to say it. He does not have any authority. Because we have, once we were under his authority, and whatever he asked us to do, we were able to do, and we did not have any other choice but to do what he asked us to do. But today, greater is he that is in us. He can tempt us, but we don't have to yield to temptation, because grace is much more powerful than sin. Hallelujah. So the devil does not have any authority over you. Then again, the question logically follows, if he does not have any authority, how come he is creating so much of problems for me in my life? Let me tell you, how does the devil gain authority in a person's life? He uses the chief weapon called lies. The Bible says he is a liar from the beginning and the father of all lies. So if he is a liar, how come he is getting so much of authority, gaining ground in your life? It simply means this: how can a lie be overcome? The lie can be overcome only by the truth. And the Bible says, know the truth and the truth shall set you free. The problem is, when you do not know the truth, his lie will appear to be so true that you think what he's saying is true. And after kind of obliging and following up with whatever he is saying, you end up in a bigger hole than you got out from. Are you with me? The Bible says he does not have any authority unless you give him authority. You and I, we need to realize we have all power and authority which Christ has bestowed upon us. Amen. So if you don't like the way your life is going, don't just sit back, throw your hands up in the air and say, I cannot do it, nothing is in my control. The Bible says you were once like that, but salvation, redemption has brought you from out of control into the control of Jesus Christ. And he has given you the authority, which is the power of your tongue, to choose between life and death. If you are eternally redeemed, you need to open your mouth and say, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, his love and his grace, it endures forever. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. You know, the Bible says, gives a wonderful example of Job. You know, we know the background to the story of Job, what happens behind the scenes, but poor Job does not know what is happening behind the scenes. So he just takes as it comes in his life. You know, first he starts, you know, it's a shock for him. Then he is struggling in his life, coming to terms with whatever has happened in his life. Loss of children, you know, loss of business, loss of health. And his reputation and his character comes under heavy scrutiny, not by the public media, but by 3 or 4 closest friends who accuse him of the integrity of his character. And when so many things are going against him, there is a wonderful proclamation by Job. And this is what he says in Job chapter 19 and verse 25. We all know it by heart, and we can say it together with Job. He says, I know my Redeemer lives. Say it together with me. I know my Redeemer lives. In what kind of context does he say? You know, I know there is a problem, but I know my Redeemer lives. Which means, I know he is powerful. I know he will redeem me from this problem. Therefore, my problems are temporary and the blessings of God are always permanent in my life. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. If you are going through a problem, you need to say these words together with me. Not just, I know my Redeemer liveth. We are living in the New Testament times. Therefore, we have to say, I am redeemed by my Redeemer. Say it together with me. I am eternally redeemed. So what is the problem? If I am eternally redeemed, how come all these problems are there? You need to approach it from this particular point of view. I've said it many times, I will say it again. You are a defending champion. Tell your neighbor, you are. Come on, you are a defending champion. In what context is that? You know, how many of you believe Christ was victorious on the cross of Calvary? You know, do you have doubts? Then you cannot partake of the communion. You know, let's start again. How many of you know Christ is victorious on the cross of Calvary? You know, if he has won, we know that. And we have also won with him. If we have been victorious together with Christ, after being victorious, when you face the first challenge in your life, you approach the particular challenge as a defending champion. You are already a champion. You are already an overcomer. You are going there just to prove that you are an overcomer. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. Look at the verse that Jesus says in John's Gospel chapter 16 and verse 33. In this world you will have, come on, in this world you will have many problems, full stop. If that's the case of the particular verse, then we have every reason, Lord, to have a long face, you know, and to worry and to be, you know, worried, sick and so on and so forth. But he says, in this world you have many troubles, but be of a cheerful heart. I have, come on, come on, I will. It's not I will overcome. I have. It's past. He has already overcome. In other words, the problem that you are facing, he has already overcome. And you are going to prove that he has overcome by you overcoming the same in your life. If you understand, say a big amen to that. Some people say, you know, oh, you do not know, you do not know what I am going through. If only you know my problem, you will not be as enthusiastic as you are this morning. I don't need to know your problem. I know the solution. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. I was talking with somebody last week, and this recurring problem comes again and again and again. A long time, but still it comes again every now and then. Probably for 3 months the problem doesn't kind of creep up, but after 3 months it kind of comes back again. It's more to do with thoughts, bereavement and so on and so forth. And this is the example that came to my mind, which I told them. So if the devil, you know, uses the problem as a lock, for example, you understand what it means by a lock? Put, you know, if he uses the problem as a lock, remember, God has given you the key. I will say that again. Why do I say that in that way? The Bible says, I have given you the keys of the kingdom. Whatever you lock will be locked. Whatever you open will be opened. Because that's the authority of redemption. So if the devil locks you in a situation, you got the key, what should you do? Come on, come on. It's very simple logic. If he locks you, lock aitanga finance la, yes, we understand. If he has locked you in a situation, God says, I've already given you the key. What should you do? Come on, how to unlock the problem? The Bible says, life and death are, come on, tarandar is same. You understand, life and death are in the power of the tongue. And the Bible says you are eternally redeemed. How did Job overcome his problem? He's got sickness in his body, lost his children, lost his business, lost his reputation, lost everything that he has. But he opens his mouth and changes the direction of his life when he proclaims, I know my Redeemer is alive. And I will see with my own eyes, even though my flesh may get decayed. But with my own eyes, I will see the goodness of God in the land of the living. Are you locked in a relationship? Are you locked in finance? Or did the devil get you locked in a corner, in a circumstance? The Holy Spirit is telling you this morning, you already got the key. How many of you got the bunch of keys this morning? Remember old ladies, those times, they have, you know, kottu savi. You understand that? Lots of keys and they have it in their... English doesn't help me at the moment. You understand. You know, they have it here. And only when they go to the ICU, they will hand it over to somebody else. You understand what I'm trying to say. So, you know, similar context. The key is not with somebody else. You know, when Christ overcame on the cross of Calvary, before he ascended, he says, take the bunch of keys. You can unlock, you can lock. I'm going to come back and we are going to be together forever. So you got the keys. Tell your neighbor you got the keys. Veetisaviye tholanju perchu pastor. You know, I lost my house key itself. How is it possible to unlock the problem? The Bible says God has given us the keys. You know, this is the key to the kingdom of God. Every problem, let me take the same logic again. Every lock has got a key. Is that not right? Every lock has got a key. If that is true, every problem has got a solution. Let me put it in another way. When we face each and every problem, there is a promise for every problem to be overcome. And say, God says, I have given you the keys of the kingdom. What is eternal redemption? It is not just, you know, getting out of the problem once and getting back into it again. No, the Bible says, no, that is not how it is. When I have redeemed you, I have empowered you not to get back into the same problem again. Probably you might be saying, yes, I understand. Sundays are good. I feel exuberant. I feel, you know, top of the world, so to speak. But, you know, after a few days, the old problem comes back to me again. Probably the high kind of lasts for a week or two. Then again, the same problem comes back to me again. That is why God is reminding you this morning, you got the key. If He locks you in a certain circumstances, you have every power to unlock yourself and stand for the glory of God. Lift your hand and say a big amen to that. The Bible says the later days of Job were much more glorious than his former days. How did it all work? Look at the last confession of Job. That's a key verse in the whole book of Job. What does he say? In Job chapter 42 and verse 2, the last one of the powerful confessions, he says, you are an almighty God. Whatever you have planned to do, you will always do it in my life. You know, that was the powerful confession that he says. You are an almighty God. Say it together with me. He is an almighty God. And whatever he has planned to do it in your life. What is the plan of God for your life? The Bible again says in Jeremiah chapter 29 verse 11, I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans to prosper you and to give you a hope and a future. If you look at the Tamil translation of it, it's slightly different, but then again, it's something very unique, I think. The Bible says, let me use the Tamil translation, நீங்கள் எதிர்பார்த்திருக்கும் முடிவை உங்களுக்கு கொடுக்கும்படிக்கு உங்கள் பேரில் இருக்கக்கூடிய திட்டங்களை நான் அறிந்திருக்கிறேன். You know, the translation itself is very different. To give you what you are expecting, I have a plan. That's the thrust of Tamil translation. What are you expecting? Vanda varatom, pona poatom. Appadithan kedaikum. What does the Bible say? I have a plan to give what you are expecting. What are you expecting this morning? You know, I don't have much expectations. I'm a spiritually mature man. You know, no. If you are spiritually mature with a God like our God, we can have high expectations and God will always do beyond our expectation. So kind of raise up your expectation this morning, month of February, only 28 days. Nevertheless, we have an almighty God. Last month there was 31 days and things didn't work out. This month is only how many days? 31லயே நடக்கல, 28ல எப்படி நடக்கும்? எனக்கு வேற 7.5. You understand what I'm trying? These are the things that some of the Christians are saying. You understand? Whether it is 31 days or 28 days, our God is an almighty God. And whatever He has planned to do, He will always get it done. I am eternally redeemed. Lift your hand and say these words together with me. I am eternally redeemed. Why should we have to say it? Come with me to Psalm 107. The Bible wonderfully puts it across as the psalmist says in these words. Psalm 107 verse 1 and verse 2. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His loving kindness is everlasting. And the Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom He has redeemed from the hand of the adversary. Let me take it one step at a time. Verse 2, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Say it together with me. Let the redeemed of the Lord say. Say what is the question? The previous verse is the important verse. The Bible says, oh, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. If He is a good God, what is He going to do? Come on, very, very simple logic this morning. If He is a good God, what is He going to do? Why can't he do bad things? Because he hasn't got any bad things. You know, let me put it in another way. God cannot give me bad things because he hasn't got any bad things to give it to me. The Bible says, every good and perfect gift comes from the Father of lights, in whom there is no shifting or any shadow of turning. If he hasn't got anything bad to give it to me, then only good will come. If that is the truth of it, how come so many bad things are there in my life? That is where another key is very, very important. You know, Joseph says, you meant it for evil, but God has meant it for good. In other words, God causes all things to work together for good to those who love God and are called according to his purpose. Lift your hand and say a big amen to that. Let the redeemed of the Lord say, he is good and his love endures forever. I'm going to say it again. We are all going to join together and say it. Let the redeemed of the Lord say, so that God is good and his love endures forever. Say it together with me. God is good and his love endures forever. Lift your hand and shout a big hallelujah. Praise God. That is redemption. You know, that is what redemption does for you and for me. We are eternally redeemed, meaning our sins are forgiven. There is a wonderful difference between Old Testament and New Testament when it comes to the forgiveness of sins. You know, for Old Testament, it is more in the context of our sins are covered for 1 year. For example, if you are having an insurance for your vehicle, and when you pay annual insurance, your vehicle is covered for how many years? 1 year. And then after the 1 year is, you know, as it going to come nearer, you will have, you know, a reminder saying your insurance is going to expire on the 5th of such and such a month. Therefore, you have to renew. Take this and keep that in your mind. That is what happened in the Old Testament. You know, one day of atonement, one sacrifice, and that sacrifice covered their sins for how many years? For 1 year. Therefore, every time the Day of Atonement comes, people are reminded that they are sinners and their sins needs to be atoned for again. That is why New Testament, the Bible says, he offered himself as a sacrifice once and for all. We have a lifetime cover and validity when it comes to redemption. Amen. Lift your hand and say a big amen. So why do we take communion? Just to remind ourselves that we have life insurance. You understand what I'm trying to say? So when you partake of the communion, you remind yourself, I am eternally covered by the blood of Jesus Christ. Say it together with me, I am eternally covered by the blood of Christ. So when you are kneeling down to receive what God has ordained for us, you know, don't think of anything else, but remember, he has done everything that needs to be done for your life and my life. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. What should the redeemed of the Lord say? God is good and his love is endures forever. Come with me to Romans chapter 5. What is another aspect of redemption? These are very fundamental truths that every Christian should know it in his heart and experience that the same in his life also. Romans chapter 5 and verse 8. The Bible says, but God demonstrate his own love towards us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Verse 9, much more than having now been justified by his blood. That's another aspect of redemption. Justified by his blood. We shall be saved from the wrath of God through him. Let me summarize that for you. The Bible says God demonstrated his love that while we were still sinners, Christ died on the cross for us. And as a result of that, by the blood of Christ, you and I, we are justified. Say it together with me, I am justified. In other words, I don't have to justify my sin because I am already justified by the blood. Therefore, I have the power not to do it again. Are you with me? Again, justified, you have to understand it from the context of a courtroom. You are there standing as the accused of sin and Father is the judge and you know, and the devil is the accuser And there you are standing, you are accused of every sin possible. You cannot deny it because you and I, we very well know that we have committed our sin. No other lawyer can take up the case because they very well know that whoever takes this case, they will lose their reputation because this case is doomed to fail. When nobody took up our case and we cannot defend ourselves, when the judgment was kind of staring at us, there came a person and who stood on my behalf, and he is called the heavenly advocate. Jesus Christ is his name. He took my case, he took your case, the case that never will win in the court of law. Jesus took our case. He paid the penalty on the cross of Calvary, and the judgment came. You are justified, declared righteous by the all-knowing God. Hallelujah. When you partake of the communion, don't partake of it as an accused, but as a person who have been had the affirmation of God inside of him, saying, I have been justified by the blood of the Lamb. Say a big amen to that. Let me put it in another way. As long as you feel accused, you will never have a smoothness in your relationship. Is that not true? How many of you understand what I'm saying? As long as you are having a sense of being an accused, I am unworthy, I am a sinner, I cannot do anything right. If that is what your mind is saying, then you can never approach the throne of grace with boldness. There will be no openness or intimacy in our relationship. That is why righteousness is one of the basic foundational doctrines that you have to have your mind fixed on it. You are a righteous man. Tell your neighbor you are righteous. I know they have done all kinds of wrong, and they themselves will say, you don't know what you are talking about. I know, certainly know. You understand that. But I didn't say you are righteous. Who said it? Come on, come on. Another logical, you know, somebody said it like this, I read it. Christianity is first cognitive and then it becomes conduct. I'll say that again. Christianity is primarily what? It's cognitive. And only then it affects our conduct. So we are going to follow a logic. Who said you are righteous? God said it. I can say you are righteous, but I don't know everything about you. So as a pastor and a good pastor, I will say there is nobody like our people. You understand what I'm trying to say? But the whole point is, I do not know. I can be wrong. My judgment can be, you know, can be full of errors, so on and so forth. But I didn't say you are righteous. I didn't say myself that I am righteous. It is God who said, I am righteous. How many of you think God's judgment is always right? How many of you think God can never lie? One of the impossibilities with God is that he can never lie. So when he calls you just, justified and righteous, he means what he says, and you are. Come on, come on, you are what? So how come me committing so much of sin, God declares I am righteous? You know, has God some kind of errors in his judgment? No, the truth is, yes, I am a sinner. Yes, I committed sin. But on the cross of Calvary, all my sins were atoned for. The blood not only forgave my sin, the blood said, this is the blood of the new covenant, which is shed for the remission of sin, for the removal of sin. Remember last week, as far as east from the west, so far as he removed all our transgressions from us. As a result of that, God declares that you are a righteous person. Lift your hand and say a big amen to that. Let me change the context for you. Righteousness meaning being in right relationship with God. Say it together with me. Righteousness is what? Is being in right relationship with God. That is why Paul says, we have received not the spirit of slavery to go back to fear, but we have received the spirit of adoption by which we can call God Abba Father. How many of you are glad that we have such a privilege this morning to call God Abba Father? Because our relationship is right with God. Maybe you are here and you are saying, you know, my relationship with God is not right. You know, I still have grievances against God. I am angry with God. How can he allow such and such a thing? How come this has happened? How come that has happened? You know, and sometimes it's the fault of our own side, and sometimes we think it is God's fault for whatever has happened in our life. Let me tell you, accusing God or accusing yourself is not going to get rid of the problem. Are you with me? But getting in right relationship with God, with whom all things are possible, that is the solution for our life. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. So if you are angry with God for another, you know, putting it in another way, where else can you go? Let me ask it again. You know, God is the only person who can help you, and you are angry with God, where are you going to go? You have no other option, but the only option is to come to God. And the Bible says, whoever comes to me, I in no way will reject them. The Bible says, if you are burdened and heavy laden, come unto me and I will give you rest. So redemption involves the forgiveness of our sin and deliverance from the control of the enemy. And number three, it puts us in right relationship with God. Not only that, that is why the Bible says in Luke's Gospel chapter 22 and verse 20, Jesus said, he took the cup in the same way, he blessed it, he said, partake of this, this is the blood of the new covenant. Say it together with me, this is the blood of the new covenant. What is covenant? What is blood covenant? You know, those days, every covenant was ratified by shedding of blood. Nowadays, we write the contract or we get into an agreement, we go to the registrar office and there we register it properly, put our thumbs to it, sign our name, get our photographs taken and so on and so forth. But those days, if a covenant has to be ratified, the blood of the person has to be shed. And the Bible says, partake of this, this is the blood of my new covenant. In other words, we are in a covenant relationship with God. Say it together with me, I am in a covenant relationship with God. Let me give you one important aspect of covenant relationship. When we are in covenant relationship with God, everything of him belongs to me and everything of me belongs to him. I'm going to say it again. You know, somebody said it in Tamil, bit more faster. And everybody said amen without realizing what you said. You understand? But real covenant is what? Everything of him belongs to me and everything of me. Who's got a good deal? I'll say that again. All of him belongs to me and all of me belongs to him. Who's got a good deal? We got a... Do you think God has got a very bad deal? You understand what I'm trying to say? No, he hasn't got a bad deal. He loves us so much that he will take us just as we are to make us more like him every day of our life. Lift your hand and say a big amen. If everything of his belongs to me, let me take it further. What is that you are lacking this morning? If you are lacking in wisdom, the Bible says he is the only wise God, which means all his wisdom now belongs to you. Say, for example, you are lacking in finance. The Bible says all the gold and silver, the earth and the fullness thereof belongs to me, which means if he has got everything and I am in a covenant relationship with God, all that belongs to him belongs to me. But you need to know how to get that and appropriate that in our life. That is why we need to come next Sunday also. You understand what I'm trying to say? That is why we need to come to the Bible study, how to use our tongue, because this is one of the keys that we have to understand in order to get, you know, what God has for us and make it applicable in our own lives. How does Paul say it? My God shall meet all your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. If I am lacking strength, for example, and the Bible says power and strength, it all belongs to God. That is why Paul says, let the weak say, or when I am weak, then I am strong. The Bible says his grace is all sufficient for me. What is all sufficiency? In my weakness, his strength is made perfect. When weakness is there and strength is made perfect. In other words, when sin increases, grace overwhelms. Therefore, the Bible says, you know, we will lack nothing when we have a God like our God. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. That is covenant relationship. When we partake of the communion, whatever you are lacking this morning, I want you to open your mouth and confess and say, Lord, all these things that I lack, I thank you that I don't have to be in lack. Whatever belongs to you, belongs to me. Partake of it, you will become part of what God has done for you. Lift your hand and say a big amen to that. The Bible says that we are in a covenant relationship, therefore all of God belongs to us, and everything of us, it also belongs to God. Putting it in another different context, our money within inverted commas is usually God's money. You understand what I'm trying to say? You know, remember what we studied or confessed this morning? All we have is what we have received it from you, and we have received it from your hand, and we are giving it back into your hand. As long as you say, this is my money, you have to protect it. You understand what I'm saying? If you say, it's my money, then God says, well, you take care of it. If you say, no, Lord, it's your money, then give it to me. You understand? Some of you got what I said. இப்படி போனா அப்படி சொல்றார், அப்படி போனா இப்படி சொல்றார். Then what do you think is covenant relationship? He is a good God. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. He is a good God, and his love endures for ever. So if you confess, Lord, this is your money, and he takes care of it, and he's got a purpose for your finance. Say a big amen to that. He's got a purpose for it. And when you say, Lord, this is your body, this is the body where the temple of it is the temple of the Holy Spirit, where the Spirit of God indwells in you. And remember, he can heal your physical body. How many of you can say an amen to that? Your house, you say, the Bible says, Lord, your house shall be a house of prayer to many nations. And let me tell you, that is your confession, people will come to your house for the purpose of getting prayed for. Hallelujah. They will say, I just came so that you will say a word of prayer. Some people come and say, mandirichittu polanu vandirukrom. Oh, vaanga. No problem. You know, I'm not a mandravadi. I'm a minister of God. You understand what I'm... It is their language. I remember a lady, she died when she was 102 years old. You know, and we went to give... Me and my wife, we used to take communion to her. And one particular month, we did not go, and she had some kind of fever or something like that. And after the succeeding month when we went, she said, நீங்க தீர்த்தம் கொடுக்காதனால தான் எனக்கு சளி பிடிச்சிருச்சு. Oh, you know, that is a revelation. You understand? For her, தீர்த்தம் is communion. For Nama people, I don't have mood this morning. I'm not going to take communion. I'm not going to say you will catch cold. You are already cold and you are lukewarm. That's another sense. You understand what I'm trying to say? You know, they have a revelation saying, all of God belongs to me and all of mine belongs to him, because we are in. Come on, we are in. Come. That is how it should work in a marriage relationship also. You know, it's not pre-nuptial agreement. You know, that is not covenant. You know, that is more contract, where you say, this is mine and that is yours. In case of you going your own way, don't ask for my car. That is not covenant relationship. The Bible says, my God shall supply all your needs according to his glorious riches. That's the goodness of redemption this morning. Appropriation. How can we appropriate what God has done for us? Come with me back to Revelation chapter 12 and verse 11. Revelation chapter 12 verse 11. The Bible says, now, and they overcame him because of the blood of the Lamb. We have looked at what the blood of the Lamb has done for us in the context of redemption, of us being justified, forgiveness of sins, deliverance from the control of the enemy, and so on. And the Bible says, and by the blood of the Lamb, and because of the word of their testimony. Now this is where accomplishment comes to the place of appropriation in a person's life. I'm going to say it again. How many of you believe Christ has accomplished everything for you? That is our belief. You know what the psalmist says. He accomplishes all things that concerns me. And in the New Testament time it is, he has accomplished all things that concerns me. If he has done it all, but now the point is, how can I appropriate what Christ has accomplished for me? I'm going to say it again. If Christ has accomplished everything concerning my life, how am I going to appropriate that into my life? And that is where the Bible says, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Say it together with me, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, they overcame the devil, the context says. So what is key for appropriating what Christ has accomplished? The word of our testimony. Say it together with me, the word of our testimony. To put it in another word, Jesus died on the cross. It's a historical fact. He rose from the dead. It's an historical fact. He lives. He's going to come back again. That's all truth of God's word. Those things, said it like that, is absolutely true. But how will that make a difference in your life? It's not saying Jesus died on the cross. It is by saying Jesus died on the cross for me. The Lord is a good shepherd. That is true. But how does David say, the Lord is, come on, the Lord is my shepherd. Until he becomes your shepherd, he remains a good shepherd for everybody else. That is why for some people it works, for some people they say it doesn't work. It is not that it works for some, it doesn't work for the others. The Bible says none should perish but all should have eternal life. Some choose to make him their own personal God, and whatever is accomplished by him for them becomes part and parcel of their life. Let me give you another illustration. There is plenty of soap and there is plenty of water and there are plenty of dirty people on earth. What's the problem? Was I too fast? I'll say it again. Plenty of water and plenty of soap and plenty of dirty people. What's the problem? It's not the lack of soap, it's not the lack of water, it's but the lack of application of the soap and water to a person. And that is what is needed this morning. He has done it all 2000 years ago. I want you to take it and apply it and be free, redeemed eternally right now this morning. Is it possible? Absolutely possible. How is it made possible? The Bible says by the word of their testimony. Let me put it in the context of this particular chapter. I'm going back to verse 10 again. Revelation chapter 12 and verse 10. The Bible says, then I heard a loud voice in heaven saying, now the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ have come. Listen to this. For the accuser of the brethren has been thrown down, he who accuses them before God day and night. Now I want you to understand how we can appropriate what Christ has accomplished on the cross for us. We have an adversary and his chief work is accusation. So say it again with me. We have a what? We have an adversary. And how does he kind of come against us? He accuses us. And the Bible says he is the accuser of the brethren. He accuses us day and night. So in the context of accusation, how are you going to appropriate what Christ has done for you? You know, remember, this is also connected with our confidence in asking God in prayer and receiving it also. 1 John chapter 3 verse 20 onwards, if you just look at that particular passage of scripture, if our heart condemns us, the Bible says, if our heart condemns us, then God is greater than our heart, and what he says is right, and we have confidence to go before the throne of God. Let me make it simpler again. You are going to pray, okay? You are in a need, and you are about to kneel down, and you are going to pray to God. And the moment you open your mouth to pray, the accuser of the brethren says, God will not listen to the prayers of a sinful man. And that too, a willfully sinful man. He says, God listened to Daniel because he was a holy man. You understand that? God listened to Christ because he was God himself. No problem. God will listen to your pastor. Why are you laughing? You understand what I'm trying to say. You know, but he will never listen to you praying. That is why some people, when they listen to this accusation, immediately they will stop praying and they will call the tower. Because they think, I am not worthy to pray. God will not hear my prayer because I hear this accusation that I am not righteous enough, holy enough, you know, good enough to pray to God and receive from Him. Therefore, I see so and so, brother there, sister here, auntie there, pastor here, and so on and so forth. So if I go to them and they pray for me, maybe what I cannot get it from God, I can get it through them. Let me tell you, there are no brokers in God's kingdom. We have a personal God and we have a personal relationship with God. You need to overcome this accusation in your mind in order to have confidence to ask God and to receive it from Him. How to overcome this accusation? So for example, the devil says, you know, that you are sinned, you know, and or to put it in another context, he reminds you of your past sin. All right, you are holy this morning, you know, because you are in church. But the problem is, he is accusing of your past sin. You know, many times in communion, you know, we say only those who are worthy enough to come to the table should come forward. That disqualifies, you know, in people's minds that they are not qualified to come and partake of the communion. The communion, to put it in another word, is a medicine to cure the sick. And you are saying that only the healthy can come and partake of it. That disqualifies all of us. You understand what I am trying to say? So the devil says, or he accuses you of your present sin, or he accuses of your past sin. If you are unable to overcome this accusation, you cannot have confidence when you come to praying to God. How did they overcome the devil? The Bible says, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. 1 John chapter 1 verse 7 to 9, the Bible says, if we confess our sins, He is just and righteous to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The point is this, confessing your sin confirms you are a sinner. I'm going to say it again. Confessing your sin confirms what? You're a sinner. So you're saying, Lord, I am a sinner. That's how it follows. Lord, I am a sinner. Okay, you are a sinner. Confirmed. You are what? You are a sinner. So confessing your sin in that kind of context only confirms that you are a sinner. So when you confess your sin and you get confirmed that you are a sinner, the devil said, that is what I have been telling you for a long time. And you go to church, you confess your sin and everybody knows that you are a sinner. And that is what I am also saying. God will not listen to the prayer of a sinful man. Therefore, your prayers will not be heard. Your problems will not change. Your status quo will be maintained. You are a doomed sinner. But the Bible says, confessing our sin means not only taking responsibility for what I have done, but also acknowledging what Christ has done to my sin. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. When I confess my sin, I say, yes, I have done something wrong, which is not right before God. I confess that I have committed a sin, but at the same time, on the same token of the word, I say, I thank you, Lord, that on the cross of Calvary, all my sin has been atoned for. As far as east is from the west, so far has God removed all my transgressions from me. Confession of my sin confirms, while confession of the Savior cancels my sin. And that is how you can overcome the devil. If you are with me, say a big amen to that. So he constantly accuses you in your mind. You are not good enough. You are not worthy enough. Your sins are not forgiven. If you are sick, for example, the first thing that will come to your mind, or the first thing that the devil will tell you, is this: sin, sickness is a result of sin. If you are sick, therefore you are a sinner, which means God has not forgiven your sin. If He has really forgiven your sin, how come you are sick now? All these things go through your mind and people come to a particular place where they think, I've done something wrong, that is why I'm having all this problem. Let me tell you, even if you've done nothing wrong, you will still have problem. I told you, the devil will lock you, but God has already given you the key. So how do you overcome the accusation of the enemy? It is by knowing the affirmations of God. You know, when the devil says you are a sinner, God says, I have forgiven your sin. You are a righteous man. Lift your hand and say big amen to that. For this to go and settle in your mind, to renew your mind, and for you to gain confidence, you need to keep coming throughout this year. Are you with me? Because some people can't even digest what I'm saying at this very moment, because we have been brought up in a traditional kind of mindset. The moment we commit a sin, we think we have lost it all. Now the Bible says, God forgives all my sin, my past, my present, and my future. And some people will get the wrong side of the stick and say, if God has already forgiven my future sins, what is wrong with doing it? No, that is where we misunderstand what God has made available for you. He has empowered you so that you don't have to commit it again. Praise God. That is eternal redemption that He has made possible for you and possible for me. What does the Bible say to overcome the accusation of the devil? If the devil can get you to feel guilty, then he can get you to feel very shameful. When he gets you to become very shameful, you will come to a place of self-condemnation. Let me put it in other words. Guilty, I have done wrong. Shame, I am wrong. Condemnation, I don't think I can ever do anything right in my life. Therefore, I myself condemn myself. But the Bible says there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. If you understand, lift your hand and say a big amen to that. I have said many things this morning, but remember, you know, God, the Holy Spirit will bring it back to your remembrance. One final verse of scripture and we are going to pray. Luke's Gospel chapter 10 and verse 19. I am going to give you another wonderful translation this morning. Wonderful verse of scripture, Luke's Gospel chapter 10 and verse 19. What does the Bible says? Behold, I have given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing will harm you. I'm going to read it again for you. If you have your Bibles open, we can all read it together. Doesn't matter, we have different versions. Let's all make a joyful noise together. Behold, I have given you authority to tread on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing, say it again, and nothing will harm me. Say it again, and nothing will harm me. Let me give you another chance. I have given you the authority and power, and I have given you physical, mental strength and ability over all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall in any way harm you. That's the power of redemption this morning. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. Let us all say together this morning, I am eternally redeemed. My sins are forgiven. I am no longer under the authority of the devil. My authority comes from God. Nothing shall harm me. Say it again together with me. Nothing shall harm me. Will you stand to your feet as we look to God in prayer this morning? Hallelujah. Every eye closed as we come to partake of what God has ordained for us this morning. As the devil got you locked in any of these circumstances, God has already given you the key. You can unlock yourself. The Bible says, when the whole earth will be covered in darkness, but the light of God's word will shine upon you. And that is how God is going to make a differentiation in your life, in your situation. When everybody else is going through whatever they are going through, God will bring you, cause you to an overcomer in your life. Hallelujah. Every eye closed, every hand lifted towards heaven. We are going to look to God in prayer this morning. You are a blessed person. You are eternally redeemed by the blood of Jesus Christ, and with whom all things are possible. Hallelujah. Lift your hand to worship God. Oh, we worship you, Jesus. Oh, the blood, it'll never lose its power. No, never. No, never. Oh, the blood, it'll never lose its power. It will never lose its power. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Sing again. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Father, we thank you for what you have accomplished through your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, on the cross of Calvary. We thank you that we are eternally redeemed, and we will overcome every challenge, every problem, by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony. I declare victory to your people in the mighty name of Jesus. We give you praise. In Jesus' name we pray. All God's people say, may the grace of our Lord Jesus, the love of God the Father, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all now and forevermore.